you can actually talk in terms of the structures of the thing, whatever it is. And so it's these, not the people, that the client can engineer. The client can engineer people very slowly with a huge advertising spend and promotional spend and all the rest of it, but actually they can modify their thing much more quickly. So let's get back to making a distinction between literal and figurative. The reason I bang on about this I just collected them, like some people collect stamps, you know. I mean, there are distinctions, conceptual frameworks, attributes versus benefits. People often get mixed up with those. It's great if you can really put a short life between them. Awareness and affinity comes onto your chart in a second. Motivators and differentiators, they're not always the same, you know. A differentiator would be green whiskey, but it's hardly a motivator, yeah? A differentiator would be Audi doesn't have as many showrooms as Ford, but it's hardly a motivator, you know. And likewise, motivators, Heineken is refreshing. Well, it's a motivator, but it's no longer a differentiator. It was once upon a time. Attributes and attitudes, product values, user values, there's loads and loads of stuff that I fell in love with, basically. I'm going to do it this way and try and find, is this wise? Try and find your picture. Probably not. Let's do this. Do you know who these people are?
Nicole.
This is an interesting chart, and we're going to come off this stuff in a minute or two because, you know, I don't want to spend a whole evening just doing this, but there's an interesting chart here because, this is one I stole. I don't make everything up. I stole this from a mate of mine called Charlie Robertson, and he stole it from somebody else, so, but it's quite good, and the reason it's quite good is that the big cheese, the client biggies like it. It's quite interesting because when you examine it, when you really interrogate it, you realise that it actually doesn't seem that much. But they like it a lot because it operates at their level. So basically what it's about is, it's about aspects of success. It's about what creates success. What does success look like for a brand? And you could argue that, people have to know about it, so awareness would be a great thing. Simple so far. Salience, possibly, so sticky out above the norm, awareness. Preference, yeah, we're getting stronger now. This is not only they are aware of it more than of others, but they prefer it. And it might even make it onto their shopping list, their consideration set. If you're really lucky, you get loyalty. You get people beginning to go, I really like Virgin. You know, I wouldn't fly with British Airways, I much prefer Virgin. You know, they allow people with unruly haircuts on board. So loyalty is often, it seems to be behavioral and attitudinal. So let me just show you this chart. And I call it the brand balance model. It's the brand balance attainment model. I'm slightly pretty good as well. So, start by, again, because you've been the short version, I didn't do a build. So you've got two axes, individual, one person, collective, lots of people. Knowledge, rational bit, and feelings, if you want to call it the emotional bit. Yeah, how people feel about your brand. And start with here, one person, on the one person side, knowing something about your brand, and we can call that awareness. Once you get to lots of people knowing about your brand, knowing, not feeling, you have reputation. So again, this is stuff that people think they know about your brand. But if you go to the preference thing, you begin to deal with, this one person has a preference for it, a liking for it, it's an affinity measurement. So this quadrant labels itself affinity. If you have lots of those, then I didn't know quite what to call this one, but I've called it culture. In other words, lots of people like that brand. An army of people all like that brand. Now, the answer is you can't get from there to there unless you travel both in that direction and in that direction at the same time. But most brands don't do that. Most brands are out of balance one way or another. People have either, you haven't managed to get many people to know about you, you've still only got a small number of people who feel really good about you, so you're a cult brand, a minority brand, or you've got lots of people who know about you, but they don't have particular strong affinity for you. So it's like, you know, you've got to hand it to those guys who make Volvo, they sure know a thing about safety, but frankly, I'm not going to buy one. Yeah? Sorry to anybody who drives a Volvo. But you get the point, I think. You know? So it's knowledge as opposed to affinity. There is, of course, this strange billiard cue-like thing in the middle as well, and that's my best attempt at drawing a third dimension, coming out of the screen and going back, because knowledge and, yeah, not affinity, but knowledge can also be negative. You could know bad stuff about them. Yeah? So that there could be at the opposite of affinity as well, whatever that is. Can't think of it offhand, but you know, rejection of some sort. So actually this becomes cubes, you know, it becomes four and then another four behind the screen. And those are the negative ones. And obviously you want to get your brand out of those eight cubes into the one that's top right, positive. Now, I mean, that's all I'll say about that, but it's an interesting chart.
Would that top right hand corner sort of match up with Mark Rose's ideas?
What ideas of Mark Rose's
heard?
Heard. Okay, to an extent it would, because I'll have what she's having. And so, I mean, that's basically, it's a function of reputation, but it's also a function of affinity,
yeah.
Desire.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I suppose it would. That's, you know, if you can drive your brand, you know, by getting people to want to do what everybody, you know, everybody's doing it, everybody's buying such and such, then, I mean, how would us actually survive, you know, thrive on that? I mean, a brand who nobody knew how to spell it, or say it, not even how to spell it, you know, and yet they all wanted it, and they ended up, you know, in the top corner. Can you see why the big shots like this? Because it doesn't actually get down onto the detail of how to do anything. It just diagnoses. It just says, this is the trouble with your brand, John. You know, you're out of kilter. Too many people know about it, but nobody wants, nobody loves it. You know, there's not enough desire in your brand. And they go, desire, that's the brief. Right,
cool, do some research.
That's a good one. Not always. Sometimes they just go up for advertising. You can see it beat them up. But, anyway, that's what that's about. It's time to hand over to you for a moment. Let me what do you want to ask me? Because it's 25 to 8. That's gosh. Do you have any questions? You can ask me anything.
But what's your best guess as where it's all going then? 5-10 years time, if we're back here.
If we're back here in 5-10 years time, I really couldn't tell you. What I do know is that it's changing so rapidly at the moment and has done over the last 5 years. There's been an acceleration in the last 5 years. Which have been interesting because they've been 5 years in a difficult zone, you know, since the discontinuity, since all the kind of there's a feeling around that things are getting better. I mean, it's an interesting thing because I think it's media driven to some extent and government department driven. Because if you look at the inequities in society, it's not getting better. You know? And something I feel personally quite angry about. But I think that I can tell you what, I can't answer your question, I can give you a little indication of some of the things I've thought very recently. It seemed to me that our industry, we did things in a certain way. Probably we were too innocent, we didn't see all sorts of other changes beginning to happen. And there are all sorts of people who came from IT, from management consultancy, from various other sort of disciplines, who suddenly were running alongside us, calling themselves the same as us, selling stuff that was different, but by the same name, using the same name. And so you're kind of going, are you researchers? You know, I don't recognize you. You know, you seem to be management consultants. You seem to be IT people. But they call themselves, you know, researchers. And they said that they were selling qualitative research. And the client community, bless them, you know, didn't seem to know any different. I mean, they're under such pressure to perform in the time allotted, etc., and to the budget that they've got. It sounded like it maybe had an answer and it was cheaper than the stuff that Roddy Glen sells, so let's have some of that. You know, and so there may be more of this still going to happen. You know, people from Planet Online, people from sort of, you know, sort of behavioural economics light, you know, various other sort of bunches. We will continue to make inroads. I think we do have to acknowledge that, you know, the days of, it's sort of like the days when, in the old days when everybody watched, there was only four TV channels, so you know, you knew that if you went into work the next morning you could talk about Corrie because everybody had watched it, you know, but now it's all different, you know, there's not the same community of interest. You know, there's so many media channels that everybody does different stuff. So I think we have to acknowledge that it's going to be more and more like that. That you have to decide which bits of stuff are going to be your stuff and concentrate on that. Frankly, the hell with the rest of it, you know, because you know it's gonna, you'll go mad if you try to run around the whole thing. That's my view. Any other thoughts, questions? What would you like to have next? More drink? go home? More slides? More anecdotes?
Are you having withdrawal symptoms
now? No. Not at all. I find myself happier now than I have been for. Okay, I've never been unhappy. I've always been a happy wee guy, but I mean, you know, yeah, I'm okay. I'm fine. I don't miss it. And that's a strange thing to say to a group of people who are still doing it, you know, but, well, look forward to that day.
It's getting further out, isn't it?
Do you want to know the story about the worst group I ever did?
You didn't tell us
about the teabag. Oh, yeah, the teabag. Right, oh, okay. Tell you what, remind me of the teabag.
Okay, yeah,
yeah.
Yes, I'll tell you the story first.
It's a funny story.
Yeah.
Right, a recruiter in Buckhurst Hill. Buckhurst Hill's in East London, northeast, deepest northeast London, Essex-y kind of area. And I do have a thing about London. Just saying as we're saying, we're here tonight, in the good offices of people who started life as a recruitment company, so you know it's worth just acknowledging that before I go on and diss them. I do have a little bit of a thing about London because I think recruitment is actually, as well as being essential, it's chronically underpaid. It's just ridiculous. I mean, I'm on record and I've got a slideshow, 35mm slides, wonderful things, much more colour intense than anything you get on a PowerPoint, you know, that I gave in 1988 to the AQRP about, you know, the industrialisation of qualitative research and including a segment about recruitment. And, you know, not much has changed. And I said then, we have to professionalise, and we have to particularly professionalise that bit, and we have to pay them more, because nobody in their right mind would do that for so little money, you know, and it's difficult. So, you know, respect. And I have a thing about where recruitment goes wrong, and my experience has been, over the years, that the area where recruitment is taken with the most cavalier kind of attitude is the ring around London, yeah, it's the southeast, and I've got this little theory, I'm too confused about nearly everything, but I call it the unsavoury donut, savoury donut is sort of Luton and sort of places like Basildon and all those towns that ring around London. If you've ever driven out of London, you know, there's a strong chance that you'll have a cone head, a Luton cone head on your tail. You know what a cone head is? Guy who's exercised so much that his neck's wider than his head.
Oh, yeah. Yeah? Oi, I'm from Luton.
So anyway, okay, I'll stop. Maybe it was from Basildon. I can't remember. Crawley. Anyway, point about it is that queer recruitment has seemed to be most collusively bad and corrosively bad in the sort of outer London suburbs, and I really sort of had quite a lot of run-ins with people about that. However, this was one occasion when it wasn't bad recruitment. The lady in question, who I can't name because but she's completely nuts. And I was working at BMP at the time, the advertising agency, and we had to test our own advertising. And those days, we had big, big video machines, and they weren't just VHS ones, they were called Sony U-matics, which were even thicker tapes, sort of like BBC standard tape. But these were vast machines, and you had to put them in the boot of your car, drive out to where you were going to do the group discussions, unload it, check that it worked, and run the thing, at a required time. I had put this machine, and they're sensitive to damp. I didn't know this, but I had put it in the boot of my car the night before, thinking, quick start off to Buckhurst Hill, it's going to take me an hour and a half from where I live in West London, so off the pop, So I get there, and I find that the machine doesn't work.
Yeah.
What to do? Need a transit round for two. The guy who was in charge of all the equipment at BMP was a terrifying big bloke called Bill Lee, who subsequently was promoted and put in charge of the company that became Bilco. Bill was quite a terrifying person, and so didn't actually kind of want to say I broke your machine. So anyway, I took this out for the client, I switched it, it didn't work, etc. And the client's place was the client turned up. He was very sympathetic to it, and he said, "Oh, I think I know a thing or two about these. Let me try and fix it." And I thought, "Oh no, Bill will kill me if I go wrong." But he said, "No, I don't. Be good at that." So he took me into the lady's kitchen. Now, meantime, this bizarre thing had happened, because when I went to the door, there was this woof 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 woof, and this great big dog, some kind of manatee dog, was throwing itself against the door. It could just see through that wee glass panel in the middle of some doors, So she kind of got hold of it, and it's puts it up in the bedroom upstairs, and you'd hear it hurling itself against the door upstairs, the bedroom, in this house in Buckhurst Hill. And she's one of these mad ladies who got great, before they were fashionable, she had great big glasses, So curly hair, great big glasses, and lipstick that looked like it had been put on by Primary 3. And she ushered me. He said, no, it'll be fine up there, just come in. Anyway, I had to make a phone call back to the ad agency to say, sorry, can you send the van man with another machine? So I spoke to Bill, and they were big, sort of shouting. The telephone was sticky. Some kind of nasty stuff. It was before mobile phones, So it was horrible. It was a sort of smelly phone or something. And I put it down. So the guy was going to come out. He managed to get to me between the two groups, perhaps. So I had to start the first group, Housewives, and it was on some kind of cereal bar or something. And so this dog's hurling itself up against the room. Housewives sit down. Everybody, I don't have a chair, there aren't enough chairs, so I sit on this sort of rather sticky, flocati rug that she'd got, which was sort of dirty carpet. And she said, it'd be much better if we let him in now, he'd be quiet, sort of thing. I said, is this right? So she let the dog down, the dog came down, and the dog had to sniff everybody really hard in the groin. There's all these housewives and me sat there, and the dog's doing it to the beer. So eventually he settled down, facing me, looking at them, trying to eat my microphone, and farted. And all the women sort of pulled their jumpers up so they looked like Wilfred from the Bash Street Kids, trying to talk to me about Harvest Crunch Bars or whatever it was. The dogs kind of, do machine in. I think the lady stayed behind for 10 minutes and I showed them the ad very quickly, did the thing with them, and that was fine. Second group came in and the client managed to come and sit with me, and he'd given the old machine that he'd taken apart and put together again back to the van and then taken it back to the alley. What I didn't know was that while he was in, this is how mad she is, while he was in the kitchen, she'd said to him, "Oh, you seem good with that. I've got a toaster, and my toaster done that. Did you saw that as well?" And he did. He did, took the toaster apart, you know. And so at the end of it all, I'd managed to show the ads more or less, and everybody had survived the dog, etc., and you know, everybody went home. And the next day, I got back to the agency, and Bill came and stood over my desk and flung this bit of metal on the desk like that. And I thought, oh, dear, he's going to pick me up. And he said, "See this bit of metal?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Looks like it's out of a toaster." So anyway, that's how that went. Teabags.
Yes.
Teabags. Basically, it was just to say, the lesson I learned from winding stuff up and actually looking at it and squeezing things till we confessed. I was working with the guy who was my main mentor, the man that I owe an awful, awful lot to, and his name is David Carroll, and he was the planning director of BMP at the time. He was a wonderful guy. And one night, we were in the agency, late, an all-nighter, because there's a pitch, a serious amount of money for PG tips, I think it was, the next day. And, later on the next day. Anyway, there we were, got all the packs lined up, and we were kind of going, "So what is it? What's going on here?" Because the advertising in the category was all about, the tea bag, the tiny, thousands of tiny perforations, let the flavour flood out, and basically saying the paper's not really there, this is what I worry about it, it won't taste of paper. And also kind of real leaf tea reassurances on the telly saying, it's not the sweepings, because it's a new thing, it's not the sweepings off the factory floor, it's real leaves, so lots of reassurance given to the job of the advertising, the above the line advertising. And we look at the packs, and apart from one, they were all pictures of teapots and cups, or modern ones, which look like coffee pots and cups. And we suddenly realised, and this was the kind of aha moment, when you line everything up and you go, "Do you know what's happening here? What's happening here is that these are the thing that the shopper has to reach out and touch and own and put in probably her trolley." Yeah? So they have to be things with which that person feels some kind of affinity. Possibly even a bit aspirational, but certainly something that is of that person's world, rather than, tea trees or factory workers or what have you. And suddenly realised that that's how the industry had assigned the tasks. It had assigned product-centred values to the advertising above the line, so reassured about the product, about the flavour, like the little holes in the bags, like it's not sweepings, like all that stuff, fresh green leaves, and assign user-centred values to the packaging, which is what the purchaser will have to actually pick up. And as soon as you pick something up, it's you. This me. And identify it and put in your bag and take it home and have it in the kitchen. So we realised that was it. It was the realisation that actually, in the middle of the night, one of these hyper intense moments, that's what's going on. That's what this is about. It's actually, they've assigned these jobs to this, these jobs to that. And there was one brand which wasn't doing that, and that was PG Tips. PG Tips had a lady tea picker, Sylvanese tea picker, or whatever, out there picking leaves, and it disobeyed the rule. So we then, the wonderful thing about this sort of realisation, it never is as thrilling to talk about it as it is when you're there at the time. You had to be there. But the interesting thing about it is that the client has probably never realised this, because you don't, as a client, you don't, as an and sit and interrogate stuff until you see it rather than simply look at it. Yeah? You look at loads of stuff, but you don't see it. And so often those moments for me have been about seeing stuff. And that's what we saw that night, David and I. And that helped us then go to the rest of the team very quickly and say, this is what's happening, these appear to be the rules, we're the odd one out, we have to decide whether we're going to capitalise on that, you know, or whether we're going to have to sort of try and persuade them to pull back into line. And we said we should capitalise on it, which is what we did. But that's, you know, that's the story about the 2 hours. Have we got time for me to do one other song? Or are we finished?
Oh, that was a free time.
You happy enough? Is that everybody happy enough on this thing? Okay. This one. So this is about gentleness to your skin while it cuts the grease on your plates. And the interesting thing was that this is what is the differentiator, and it's a secondary motivator and a secondary benefit. But the main motivator is we have to understand what fairy is, and that fairy is a detergent, a washing up liquid detergent. That does the job well. And to make it different, babies, no, forget it. But that's what the baby's for. And it was very, very interesting just realising that actually that's what that is. Again, the difference between looking and seeing. I've walked past that thousands of times, and all of a sudden, there.